والصلاه والسلام على سيدنا ونبينا اشرف الانبياء والمرسلين رحمه للعالمين خاتم النبيين شفيع المذنبين ابي القاسم محمد والصلاه والسلام على اله واهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين المظلومين ولعنه الله على اعدائهم اجمعين من الان الى يوم الدين. وقال الله سبحانه وتعالى في كتابه الكريم وهو اصدق القائلين: أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، إنما يريد الله ليذهب عنكم الرجس أهل البيت ويطهركم تطهيرا. اللهم صل على محمد. أما بعد، رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي آمين يا رب العالمين. All the praise and all the glory belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who is the true sovereign of the universe. I hope the brothers there can listen to me. Can you hear me all right? Alhamdulillah, thanks. If not, let me know and I will try to speak loud, inshallah. Now, you know, we have decided, you know, I have come to realize, first, when I first heard about this, I did not really believe it. But then when I saw it myself, I have come to realize that, you know, that there is a movement, very strong movement, that is trying to dissuade our youths from Islam. There's also a wider movement in the world to create one singular government in the world that is totally another current that is actually running. But the most dangerous current that we have right now in the world, and particularly in the Western world, particularly after 9/11, is to move youth away from Islam. And this movement is very strong in North America, also here in Canada as well. So there are many youths in our homes, our own children, who otherwise would do what we tell them to do as parents, but really they belong to totally different ideology, totally different ideology. As a matter of fact, they get emails, supposedly coming from MSA, Muslim Students Association, so that they can show their parents that they are going to a meeting of Muslim students. But they are not going to the meeting of Muslim students, they are going to those meetings of youths that were previously Muslims. So previously Muslim youth groups. Now, I told you last time that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created human beings as his supreme creation. There's no other creation superior than human beings. Everything else is subservient to human beings. Everything else. Whether Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created everything in the celestial world, in the heavens, all the planets are subservient to human beings. All the terrestrial things, everything that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created on the earth is also totally subservient to human beings. Human being is the only one who can use and exploit all those things. That is why they are subservient. You know, recently, about a year ago, a plane was built that could fly, and it flew 28 hours without fuel, only the solar power. Human beings have got that capacity to make everything else that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created for their use, because everything else is subservient. Human beings are the, why human beings are the most superior? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given them speech, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given them akal, and most importantly, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said when he created Nabi Adam alayhi salam, he put in Nabi Adam alayhi salam, wa nafakhtu fihi min ruhi, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, that I put in him of my own spirit. So each and every one of us carries that spirit of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which makes us the most superior being. And after this most superior being, the most superior, the cream of creation, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, are you. The ummah, the khairul ummah, the best of the creation that I have created you. So that there's a purpose for you. Your purpose is to enjoin good in the world and forbid evil. This is our purpose. Now, so because then human beings are more superior, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given them akal. Now the problem with this akal is that with the creation of the human being, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has also, there was also this, you know, this rise of evil at the same time, shaitan. Now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us about shaitan in so many places in the Quran. That you know that he is the open enemy, right? Even in Surah Yasin. Ya ayyuhal mujrimun. You know the beautiful passage in the Quran. Ya ayyuhal mujrimun. Mumtaz al-yawma ayyuhal mujrimun. Alam ahad ilaykum ya bani adama an la ta'budu shaitan. Innahu lakum aduwwum mubin. He is your open enemy. This is not the only place. There are several other places in Surah Yusuf as well. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And many other places as well. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says the shaitan is your enemy. So now what does the shaitan do? That he actually uses our akal to beguile us. Now because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us akal, we think. And we see things around us. And this akal moves us to make conjectures, to give us ideas. And I told you about so many ideas last week, right? I told you that ideas that, you know, that you know, especially starting from the 19th century, you know, that we are all really the progeny, we are all, our forefathers were actually chimpanzees and gorillas. We have actually evolved from them, okay? Or you know that why do we have a need to wear clothes when human beings are created? Are they created with clothes? Are they born with clothes? They are not born with clothes. So we don't really need this. This is all, you know, chaining us down. So then start nudist clubs. You know, there are nudist clubs here as well, in Toronto and in many other places in the Western world. In France, it is totally open as well. You know, nudist clubs. You know, like that, there's so many other ideas. You know, the dominating urge for a human being is to dominate over others. Or that we are all the, you know, creatures of, you know, environment. So we are all really, I mean, human being in this theory means absolutely nothing. We are either gorillas or you know, we are the product of an environment. Or, you know, that this life is, you know, nothing but, you know, accident. We all came by accident. Nothing really matters. Now this kind of ideas then that human beings carry because of the akal given, you know, I told you last week, I told you the two-line shayari of Iqbal. Ye jo akal hai, ye chirag-e raah hai, manzil nahi hai. This akal is like a lamp. It shows us the path, but it doesn't show us the actual goal. To the goal, we have to use not only our sensual perceptions, but our rational perceptions as well. This is Allama Tabatabai is saying, that you know that unless we use sensual perceptions, well, what are sensual perceptions? Things that we can touch, things that we can see, things that we can smell, things that we can hear, and the things that we can test. Five sensual perceptions. Okay, but this sensual perception will put us into wrong if we do not use with sensual perceptions rational perceptions. Otherwise, you will only begin to think, you know, what came first, a chicken or an egg? If we don't think rationally, then, you know, you will never come to the conclusion by using only sensual perceptions. Because your answer then will be, if you use only sensual perception, your answer will be, it was an accident in history. Which came first, chicken or egg? You are not using your rational perception. You want to say to yourself, I will only believe on those things that I can see, that I can touch, that I can smell, that I can hear, and that I can test. Five sensual perceptions. Now, if we do not use rational perception with that, then you will come to the conclusion will only be that it was an accident in history. And you look at all this theory in 19th century, the conclusion is that it was an accident in history. How did we come into this world? It was an accident in history. This was just an accident. This life means absolutely nothing. We have got this, you know, this, because of special genes and because of the viruses, you know, that we all, that, you know, that we have got brain and we think about brain. When we die, that's it. There's nothing else. finished. Now you know, just think about this. If you think that there is no accounting, if you think that this life is the only thing that we are here only by accident, and that there is nothing like accounting, then I will live only for this world. I will have no respect and no love for anything else. I will not respect my parents. I will not respect any laws. I will do nothing that I am required to do to make myself successful. I will live only for myself. If I can take away a dollar from your pocket and put it in my pocket, then this will be my goal in this life. If I don't think sensually and rationally at the same time. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, tells us so beautifully in, you know, Surah At-Tin, for example. وَالتِّينِ وَالزَّيْتُونِ وَالتُّورِ سِنِينَ وَهَذَا الْبَلَدِ الْأَمِينِ لَقَدْ خَلَقْنَا الْإِنسَانَ فِي أَحْسَنِ تَقْوِيمٍ. But the same insan, ثُمَّ رَدَدْنَاهُ أَسْفَلَ سَافِلِينَ. He can become lowest of the low. إِلَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ فَلَهُمْ أَجْرٌ غَيْرُ مَمْنُونٍ. فَمَا يُكَذِّبُكَ بَعْدُ بِدِينٍ أَلَيْسَ اللَّهُ بِأَحْكَمِ الْحَاكِمِينَ. So then now, how do we deal with this? Because we have got this problem. We have got real problem. I was not believing it, but the stories that I've told, I can't even speak from this mimbar, from this chair. You know, the stories that are happening in our families without our knowing. You will think that your children are in the room in the night doing their studies. The next day is examination. Their room is closed, they are on the computer. It is in the middle of the night. Do you think that they are doing real studies? You'll be surprised. No. They are doing things that are mind-boggling. You will not even know things that they are doing. So we have got this problem. Especially also if the parents also get such kind of ideas, then it is even more dangerous. You know, the youth parents, you know, young parents, if they get, you know, that kind of ideas, you know, think about it, because this kind of conjectures, this kind of ideas, they are like viruses. And what is the property of the virus? The property of virus is that it multiplies. When it multiplies, you become pregnant with ideas. When you become pregnant with ideas, you want to speak about it. So a father is speaking about his ideas on the dining table. Children are listening, and children are now getting those ideas. They are getting the same evil viruses in them. And what they say? My father has said this. He must be right. Look, it looks so true. Look at this life. It means nothing. Right? So then, the thing is that, you know, that what we have to really think about this is, you know, to first of all, for us to understand really the truth. Are all these ideas, all these theories that we have, is there truth in it or no truth? Or is the truth really what we have been taught in Islam? That Islam is the only truth. Now, I have spent my life on this. Now I'm 69 years old. From the ninth year of my life, I have actually studied all this, because I always wanted to follow the truth. And I've come to a definite conclusion, that the truth is Islam. When I have to recite any majlis anywhere for any mayyat, you know, the first thing is to say that Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen, that this marhum died in as a Muslim. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu ittaqullaha haqqa tuqatih wa la tamutunna illa wa antum muslimun. How true. So now, how do we come to the truth? How do we find the truth? You see, the way to find the truth, and I had spoken about this first time in our baby masjid, in the new baby masjid, we built it in 1979, in 1980s, for the first time I spoke in baby masjid, and I said that, you know, there are three things that we cannot change. If we take these three things as a pillar and build a platform, and then we think about this ourselves on that platform to arrive to the truth, And then we will see that we will arrive to the truth. And that truth then will be the truth that we can then propagate to our own families. Because in Islam, each and every one of us has got three-pronged responsibilities, three-pronged. First responsibility is to ourselves, individually. Second responsibility immediately after that is to our families, to our own families. And third, most important responsibility as well, that after fulfilling my responsibility and my family's responsibility, the third is to my community, and to the community, to the whole world. This is the responsibility that each and every one of us has. We are social animals, we mingle and we socialize and we love each other, and you know, we've got all the thing. But you know, think about this, that you know, when we die, we will be individual. Each and every one of us is going to go in his or her qabr alone. And therefore then it is absolutely important that we go back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in a state where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is pleased with us. When the moth comes, we say to ourselves, we know something tells us, Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. We hear, Irji ila Rabbiki, ya ayyuhal mutma'inna, ya ayyuhal nafsul mutma'inna, irji ila Rabbiki. Oh, the tranquil soul, return to me. And that will be the success. So how do we then get to that platform? And you know, this is, I'll be very, very quick, and then just about 5 minutes. Then we are going to continue this. Please try to get your family members. I know it is a sacrifice, but you know, please try to get your family, because very, very, very important. Then let's have a debate. You know, let's have youths who can debate. You know, those youths who have really understood and those youths who have not understood. You know, let's have debate. You know, let's see how we can improve things. Now, the three pillars then that I was actually talking about, three things that we cannot change. One is our birth. We cannot change that. This is our pillar. This is the first pillar that now we are building. This is the foundation. We cannot change that. Second pillar is our death. We cannot change it. I don't know when it will come. When it will come, it will just come. I cannot change it. There's nothing I can do about it. And the third pillar is the day of judgment. That I cannot change. Now, there's two things we know, because we see every day, right? Birth and death. But this is the third thing that we do. It is the third thing that all the theories in the world that are using, they are beguiling people on this third pillar. Is there really going to be the day of encounter? How can it be? Millions of years, okay? Bodies dead, buried, petrified totally, everything gone, even bones are gone. And now you are telling me that the day will come when we will be raised again, including, as Quran says, even your fingers? How can it be? What proof do you have? But look at this world, we have got all kinds of proof. You know, that we are the product. We are the product of environment, we are the product of, you know, chimpanzees and all those theories. So now, how do we come to this, you know, this third pillar and say to ourselves, this is truth? Exactly like birth we cannot change, death we cannot change, day of judgment we cannot. How do we come to that conclusion? So this third pillar also becomes as strong as the first two pillars. This is the very first thing that we have to know. Is there any instrument that we have in this world that we can use to say that this is telling us that this, the third pillar, is the truth? The only instrument that we have for that, and we are the only ones holder of that instrument, is the Quran, the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Through Quran, and only through Quran, and the Sunnah of Rasulullah, and the guidances in the Sunnah of Masumin alayhi salam, we come to the conclusion that Quran is the only thing that teaches us, that shows us without any doubt, this third pillar. Okay? So now, the question is, you know, the youths may ask, but how do you know that Quran is true? How do you know that, you know, that whatever Quran says, you know, Quran says that, you know, that there will be the day of judgment. How do you know? So now what we have to do, our first task will be to find out whether really Quran is true or not. So really, for our that pillar to be strong, we have to be absolutely knowing for sure, not only convinced, not only theories, but ourselves should be totally convinced. How do we arrive at it? And this is what we will be looking at. How do we arrive? Because, you know, in one place Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even in Surah Yasin, وَاتَّخَذُ مِن دُونِ اللَّهِ آلِهَةً لَا لَمْ يُنْصَرُونَ لَا يَسْتَطِعُونَ نَصْرَهُمْ وَهُمْ لَهُمْ جُنْدٌ مُحْضَرُونَ. That, you know, in this world, you know, there are ideas that we begin to take, you know, now those ideas become like deities for us, you know, like gods, because we believe in those ideas and we become the followers of those ideas. We support those ideas. Okay, so وَاتَّخَذُوا, we take مِن دُونِ اللَّهِ instead of Allah, وَاتَّخَذُوا مِن دُونِ اللَّهِ آلِهَةً, other deities, and we think, you know, that they are helping us in this world, but they are not helping us. As a matter of fact, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that on the day of judgment, you will be raised as the jund. وَاتَّخَذُوا مِن دُونِ اللَّهِ آلِهَةً لَعَلَّهُمْ يُنْصَرُونَ لَا يَسْتَطِعُونَ نَصْرَهُمْ وَهُمْ لَهُمْ جُنْدٌ مُحْضَرُونَ. And they will be raised, we will be raised on the day of judgment as the jund of those ideas, of those gods. So what does jund mean? Jund means troops, supporters, supporters of those ideas. You know when we do the dua, la ilaha illallah ilahan wahidan wa nahnu, and then towards the end it is Allah's wa azza junda wa hazam al ahzaba wahda. Okay, that is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will support his jund, his troops, the troops of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So, you know, so to be raised as the jund, so that even if we just support the ideas, we may not be following those ideas, even supporting those ideas can make us into the troops of those who are on the wrong. So then we have to look at this. And you know, now, I've spoken in as an introduction quite a bit, so I will not go into it now. But I will show you, inshallah, next time, the exact way, in the simplest way, to find out whether Quran is really truth. If the Quran is the truth, then the pillar is the truth. But how do we know, even for the most common man, how can one know that Quran is really true? This is, inshallah, we'll be looking at. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide us. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us from his jund when we get up on the day of judgment, inshallah wa ta'ala. Allahumma akfir lana wal mu'minina wal mu'minat wal muslimina wal muslimat ala ya'imin wal amwat wa ta'aba bainana wa bainam al khairat innaka mujibu da'wat innaka ala kulli shayin qadir. Sallallahu ala nabi.